good morning to you again right here, and welcome to the little studio on this Sunday morning right here in Wilkes County, North Carolina. Glad you could come by and be with us for a few minutes. Miss Ann's running the camera back there, and I'm holding this chair down, and I think I'll do a pretty good job of that. And we want to spend a few minutes with you, if you'll hang around, so we can speak about the Lord and His Word and what it means to us. And if you happen to be lucky enough to have a cup of coffee or something to drink this morning, cheers to you. I'm back on the cherry juice for a while. And I will have to say, thank the Lord, first of all, for those that have prayed for my knees. That prayer is working. And I'm able to get around a little better now, in the garden in particular. And I think the cherry juice is happening, and some of the vitamins that I've been taking seem to be happening, helping along as well. So thank you so much. Do be with us for the next few minutes if you can, and if you happen to want to continue to worship with us, then come on over to Arbor Grove Methodist Church. If you can't be there in person, you can do it online at 10 o'clock this morning. If you happen to be following us on Facebook, just go to the Facebook page of Arbor Grove Methodist Church in Purlier, North Carolina. We'd love to have you there. Pastor Susie has been in the recording studio this week, cutting some old hymns up in Asheville, North Carolina, at Van Atkins' place, and she's just got a good batch of old songs that I know are going to be a blessing to those that get to hear them. As we go to the Lord in prayer this morning, we want to first thank Him for letting us live. And if there's something that is on your heart or on your mind, we invite you now to go to the Lord in prayer. He says, where two or more of us are gathered together, His Spirit will be there also. He will listen to our prayers. And we just praise Him for letting us have that kind of audience with Him. So let's go to the Lord for a few minutes. Father, thank you so much for letting us live today. We thank you each day for that, because we know that it's a privilege, and we know that you have something for us to do. Help us discover what that is, and help us do it to the best of our ability, of course, with your help, first of all, in the situation. And for those that we're worried about today, that we're concerned about, this may be our sick folks, for somebody that's down on their luck in some way, having trouble with life, those that have sadness for whatever reason, those that are worried, those that can't cope with the situation very well. We lift all these people up to you, and we ask that your hand in their life be what brings them back to a good reality. And we ask that you have mercy on all of us, particularly those that don't know you, that you will just give them the extra special chance to know you in a real way. And Father, we lift up our nation to you as well in the short time we've got here. We know that we have a lot of problems, and we've brought a bunch of these problems on ourselves, but we ask your hand in the functioning of our country. You gave us such a great place to live here, and we know that it wasn't free. So we ask that you be the guiding force for us here in our country, and be with our leadership, regardless of who they are. Let them know that you're really in charge, and that you will help them as they rule. And Father, we ask forgiveness of our sins, and we ask that you be with those that hear the broadcast this morning, that it be something that'll uplift them and make their day brighter, and bring them closer to a relationship with you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You know, for those of you that might have been looking up about a week ago, this past Thursday and Friday night, you may have been aware of the presence of what the scientists call the aurora up there. I think aurora borealis was the term we were taught in school. that display of lights whenever things happen on the sun and those solar flares come out. My granny used to call it the Aurora Borealis. And so she asked me if I'd ever seen that, and I said, well, no, and she would tell me about it. But the Aurora Borealis was a beautiful display of pink and green lights due to what we're told are solar flares and storms on the sun when that energy comes shooting out, and it affects our atmosphere, and it's visible at night. And you probably got treated to a real good fireworks show at night for two or three nights if you didn't have clouds obscuring it. Miss Ann and I got some pictures. A lot of folks across the country got to see this thing, and it doesn't happen that often. But back in the early 1900s, here in rural Wilkes County, in around Miller's Creek and Prelier over there in particular, there was a night or two of these lights. I think it was in the 30s. Late 20s, early 30s, that these things appeared, and boy, it was brilliant, like it was this past week. And back before the days of computers and televisions and cell phones, the local people there, as they were many places in the country, were scared out of their wits when they saw it. And particularly at night, they thought that the mountains, some of them thought the mountains were on fire. And others, a lot of other people, thought that this was a sign of the end of time and that it was imminent, it was coming. Well, many of them banded together over there around Miller's Creek and Prelier, and they came up to the home of my great-grandfather, Ambrose Pierce, who was a local justice of the peace. And he was a man that had a fine education for his day, particularly in science as well as law. And the squire, as they called him, they kind of nicknamed him that, he calmed them all down the night that they came up, and he explained to them that this is a natural, normal occurrence, but it just doesn't happen very often where you can see it. And that seemed to satisfy them. They took his words to heart. So they went home, and they went to bed, and they got up the next morning, and they did what they usually did. They milked the cows and slopped the hogs and hoed the corn and generally got back to work, wherever that might be. Now, it seems to me that I hear a lot of folks these days talking about or wondering about the end times, or when will the end actually be. There's books written on it. People talk about it. At work, they talk about it at church. The subject of eschatology is a big thing. And they wonder when this is going to take place. And for those of you that have read the Bible quite a bit, you know that people in Bible lands during Bible times had that same concern. We've always had it. Even our most recent Sunday school lesson out at the Arbor this past weekend contained the scripture where Jesus promises to be with us until the end of the world. Until the end of the world. And one scripture says to the end of the age, depending on which translation you're reading. Now you can find that, the big one, you can find in Matthew chapter 28, verse 20. Matthew 28, 20. You go read it for yourself. He promises this. Well, the disciples that were following Jesus were curious about that very thing, just like we are. And four of them, according to Scripture, if you go to Mark chapter 13, came to Jesus and asked him when these terrible things in the end times that had been prophesied for a long time were going to happen. And Jesus answers them in the beginning of verse 5. This is Mark chapter 13, and it starts at verse 5. Let's read his answer. And Jesus answering them began to say, "Take heed, lest any man deceive you. For many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. And when you shall hear of wars and rumors of wars, be ye not troubled. For such things must needs be, but the end shall not be yet. For nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be earthquakes in divers places, and there shall be famines and troubles. These are the beginnings of sorrows. But take heed to yourselves, for they shall deliver you up to councils, and in the synagogues ye shall be beaten, and ye shall be brought before rulers and kings for my sake, for a testimony against them. And the gospel must first be published among all nations. But when they shall lead you and deliver you up, take no thought beforehand what ye shall speak, neither do you premeditate. But whatsoever shall be given to you in that hour, that speak ye. For it is not ye that speak, but the Holy Ghost. Now, if you folks know anything at all about history, then you know there have been times of persecution for the people that believe and follow Jesus ever since he uttered these words over 2,000 years ago. It was that way in the Roman Empire of that day. It's been that way in history ever since, even today. But we also know that the world hasn't ended yet. And in Scripture, Jesus doesn't tell us an hour, a date, or any other specification as to when this will happen. As a matter of fact, in other scripture, he tells us that only God knows that day and that time. But what he does tell us, and what we want to be concerned with today, and what he puts emphasis on, is what's going to happen before it takes place, and what we need to be about. And that's important to us here and now, not just in the future. Verse 5 and verse 6 has just said that some people are going to try to deceive us. They're going to lie to us and tell us that they know the best for us, that they are the voice we need to listen to, even claiming to be the voice of God sometimes. Well, if we have Jesus in our heart to begin with, if it's a lie, we'll see through it. He'll see to that, if we have him in our heart. Because that's exactly the same kind of lie that Satan told Eve in the Garden of Eden. He said, "Don't believe God, believe me. I'll tell you the truth." Well, we know how that worked out. Giving our heart and our trust to Jesus Christ will protect us. It will insulate us, not from harm or persecution, but it'll insulate us from this lie all the way to the end. We'll know who Jesus is, and we'll know who Jesus isn't. Now let me ask you, do you watch the news? Do you worry over the wars and the fighting worldwide? We're fighting just every corner now, it seems. Even right here in our own streets, we're so polarized against each other. I wish it weren't true. I wish it were not true. But Jesus said it's going to take place, and it has for 2,000 years. Some of you listening may have fought in some of those foreign wars. Some of you may have experienced being in an earthquake or another natural disaster like he talks about. And while most of us here may not have been through a famine before, a big food shortage, there's some of you, I'll guarantee you, that may be listening that might not have a roof over your head. I don't know who you are and what your situation is. You might not have the promise of the next meal you get. There are all types of food shortages. Jesus says these things and other things will be between where we are now and where the world comes to an end as we know it. Those situations are going to be here. We're going to be part of them. I don't say that for us to worry about it, because what I want us to do is look at what he puts a sharp emphasis on. And that's how we will deal with the hard times to come. Some of this means being persecuted for our faith in him. There's never been a time since Jesus came out of the tomb that people haven't been ridiculed for believing it or harmed for preaching it. But that scripture says that the gospel must be preached in all the world. That means all of us have to preach that gospel. Those that have Jesus in our heart, that's our job. That's what he says at the end of Matthew. And four other gospels, by the way. Five places we're told what that commission is. To accept Jesus into our heart is to invite the criticism of the world. Yeah, there's going to be people that are down on us because we believe in Him or we preach His story, but even then, and in particular, even then, Jesus says He will never leave us. He won't leave us. We don't even have to worry about what we're going to say when we're judged by the world's sinful standards and allowed to speak about it. Because in that time, Jesus says that the Holy Ghost will speak through us. Through us. We're the conduit. We're the horn. And the Spirit will speak through us. We don't even have to get in advance about what we're going to say. We don't have to worry about that. Now, seeing that hard times come to all folks, this is a comfort to me, and I hope it is to you. You know, I can pick a few instruments and I can run my mouth with the best of them. But when it comes to witnessing, I'm not good at it. I never have been, and I have to rely on Christ to give me the opportunity and the words to do it. The main point is this. We cannot witness holy things by ourselves because we are sinful, not holy. Only the presence of the Holy Ghost speaking through us will get the witness job done. And unless we have it within us, living in our heart, our only words will just be a racket. It'll just be somebody babbling their own thoughts and their own prejudices one way or another. If we will concern ourselves with letting the Spirit of Jesus work through us, guiding our hands and our feet as we try to help others around us, guiding our tongues as we speak who and what is living in our heart to help others cope with their lives, then it won't matter what time the end of time is going to be when it occurs. We're not going to be worried about that because Jesus is going to be with us all the way through to the end and beyond. Everything that Jesus taught us simply reminds us to work while the workday is here. This is our job for here and now. And Jesus has promised us that if we repent of our sin and ask Him to come into our lives, He will be with us, even past the end of the world. Amen. Pastor Susie and I were up in Asheville this week recording, and this is one of the songs that we did. My great-grandfather, the Justice of the Peace, liked this song. We have several of his writings and things, and we like to. There's several songs he did that we still do in the Methodist Church. Our Arbor Grove Church was very important to him.
Tempted and tried, we're oft too made wonder what it should be thus all the day long. While there were others living about, faithful till death, saith our loving Master. Short is our time to labor and wait. Then will our toiling seem to be we shall pass through the heavenly gate. Farther along we'll know more about.
just need to keep plowing. We need to keep working, folks. I'll be telling you along about the recordings that Pastor Susie, Cousin Eric Ellis went up, played some guitar and banjo on this, and you may want a copy of that. And this is not an advertisement. She's not trying to sell them. We just want people to have them. And so we'll be telling you about that along as we go. You take care. Have a blessed week, and hope to see you next week. Bye-bye.